The name of the game now is streamlining as Equinox glides through the mechanics and motives of speed skiing.
Feel an incredible surge. The wind almost blows you back off your feet, so it feels like you're going to be blown off your feet. You feel very light as you're actually skiing above 100 miles an hour. You're very light, very fragile, almost like a skimming stone bouncing with very little contact between the ski and the snow. Like when you go over the first line of the trap, you can see the other line, but it seems to take forever to arrive, although it's only 1.5 seconds, it seems to take forever.
Speed skiers are the drag racers of the skiing world. Their objective is to travel in a straight line as fast as they can. With only their skis between them and the surface of the snow, they regularly reach speeds over 130 miles per hour. 0 to 60 miles per hour in 2.5 seconds rivals the acceleration of a Formula One racing car. But of course, speed skiers don't have high performance engines or turbochargers, nor do they have the multi-million pound technological development associated with motor racing. The only motor they use is gravity.
I think the closest thing I can compare it to is flying. When you have a real smooth run anyway, it's just a real special and surreal experience. This was a little bit rough today, so I didn't really get the real quiet feeling that you get sometimes. I was getting bounced around a little bit, but I did a real good job of holding my position, so I think that's why I won.
The only similarity is probably riding a motorbike, if you've ever done that. The wind pressure is fairly strong, more like a liquid than a gas.
Michael Prüfer, the current world record holder, his record is 223 kilometers an hour, 139 miles an hour, and he's in second place following this run. His speed was 201 kilometers an hour, and I expect that he's going to be going really fast on the last run that's coming up.
C'est une sensation assez extraordinaire, et je crois qu'on peut difficilement la décrire. Pour pouvoir décrire ça, il faudrait pouvoir le vivre.
Michael Prüfer has travelled faster than any other human unaided by mechanical assistance. The power is the force of gravity pulling the speed skier down the slope. The only thing holding them back is the friction of their skis on the snow and the aerodynamic drag of their bodies. Speed skiers believe that speeds in excess of 150 miles an hour are possible. A speed skiing race is a very simple event. It is held on a steep, smooth piece of snow, often at high altitude. There are three distinct zones: the 40 degree acceleration zone, a 100 meter timing zone, which they cross in 1.5 seconds, and the deacceleration zone. But however simple the theory, high performance requires preparation. What is the most important information for the team managers?
We like to measure the temperature of the snow, the air temperature. We would like to know the relative humidity of the air and also the atmospheric pressure. and also whether there's going to be sun on the track when the race takes place. What we are looking for is the snow that you traditionally get at the end of the season, which is a fairly coarse, granular structure. It's also got a fairly high moisture content. This snow tends to be a lot faster than the new snow.
Most of us do not think of snow in terms of being fast or slow, but in high-performance skiing, correctly identifying the type of snow and preparing for it with the correct ski waxes will win the race. To identify the type of snow, it helps to know what snow is.
Snow is a product of one of the most wonderful things on the planet, water. Water droplets have this supercooling effect where, whilst they're below 0 Celsius, they haven't frozen into solid particles, and they won't freeze until you get a seeding particle entering them. Now, that seeding particle can be dust, bacteria, very small ice particles, but it has to penetrate that droplet before the freezing process actually takes place. It's already cold enough to be ice, but it hasn't turned to ice until this droplet hits it and it goes zap, and all of a sudden it's a snow crystal. Having formed one snow crystal, it then doesn't look much like a snowflake that we'd understand, because it's very small, it's got a dendritic shape, it's got fingers sticking out of it. So it now starts to fall, because it's now a little bit heavier than the particles adjacent. Falls down through warmer and colder layers, gradually starts to melt in a little bit as it gets through the warmer layer, which generates another zapper freezing effect, and we get a bigger particle. This goes on for perhaps 24 hours, and the thing grows and grows, a few others collect with it, and all of a sudden, it's so heavy that it just has to fall out, and that's the snowflake that we'd all recognise.
When it lands, it comes in pretty little crystals. Very shortly after that, the tails, as it were, of the crystals are removed, either through melting or abrasion with the other crystals. And ultimately, after a series of melting and refreezing cycles, you end up with more or less round balls of snow, rather like ball bearings.
At this automatic snow station, scientists studying snow, nevologists, observe the relationship between the snow cover and the weather in order to predict the way that snow will change. These automatically monitored sensors record every relevant change in the weather. Snow is one of the most unstable, naturally occurring substances. It can change its properties in seconds, but even in totally stable weather, it will change its form in minutes. It requires extremely careful research and data gathering to attempt to predict the type of snow that will occur during a race, especially as the situation can change in seconds if a cloud passes over the sun. Continuous records help to build a history of snow from samples that are collected. Careful checking now will later confirm that the snow has remained stable upon its arrival at the laboratory. Firstly, the crystal size and form is checked. Then a measurement of the amount of free water in the snow. This is one of the most important measurements in ski preparation. Sampling is done with infinite care. Any pressure on the snow will cause structural changes, and compression at this stage would alter the standard sample amount, which is precisely half a litre. The sample tube is sharpened to cut cleanly into the snow with the least possible disturbance. At the laboratory, the temperature is never allowed to exceed minus 8 degrees centigrade. Here, snow samples are kept in the most stable conditions possible until they are needed for experiments. This snow sample is being prepared so that its albedo can be measured. The albedo is the amount of light reflected from a surface, and conversely, a measurement of how much light is absorbed. Any disturbance to the sample by compression must again be avoided. The albedo measurement tells scientists precisely how much free water is contained in the sample. The wetter the snow, the more light it absorbs, which causes it to melt, releasing even more water. The sample is placed in what's known as an integration sphere. This is a dome containing a measured amount of light of known wavelengths, whose interior has a standard reflectance value. The amount of light absorbed by the snow is measured with a fiber optic probe linked to a computer. In turn, the computer generates a profile of the amount of light absorbed throughout the depth of the sample, thereby showing how wet the snow is. This is an invaluable measurement for predicting both the performance of skis and the way in which a snow slope will change. This sample is 4 weeks old and has been prepared for examination by light microscope. Snow crystals are classified according to structure, shape, and crystal size. Nevologists need lengthy and complicated descriptions to identify a particular type of snow. They use phrases like typical large aggregates of densely packed firm snow, grains frozen together. But attempting to classify snow is not a new idea, and the Inuit Indians who live in Arctic Canada have over 50 words for differing types of snow. The Inuit classification is based on its properties for walking over, sledging on, and building with. These words have evolved because the Inuit depend on their ability to classify snow for their survival. They have lived with snow for thousands of years and know that it is never stable. Skiing has existed for over 4,500 years. It originated in Scandinavia and Russia, and it evolved the same way as the wheel, as a solution to a problem. In a landscape covered in snow and ice for 6 months of the year, with a population existing largely by hunting, a method of getting around evolved, and skis stopped the hunter from sinking chest deep into the soft snow. It also proved to be an extremely efficient method of transport, and long distances could be covered in a day. Today, skis are such a major part of life in Scandinavia that a museum has been built at the Holmenkollen ski jump in Oslo.
In older times, there was skis made of wood for hunting. That was the main purpose, to survive in a way.
These early skis were carved from solid planks and were very long, crude, and heavy. Originally, only a single pole was used. It often doubled as a hunting weapon or a tool. The baskets at the bottom of the poles were constructed from materials to hand: reindeer horn, thongs, and birch wood. This action using a single pole is very similar to punting. It uses the strength of the arms, chest, and shoulder muscles, which helps to take the strain from the legs. These skis are over 100 years old.
In about 1850, we had a man called Sondre Norheim, and the most of the credit for the modern alpine skiing goes back to him. And he won all the competitions, and people asked, what is happening here? And they started looking at his skis, and they wanted to have such pair of skis with in curved sides, with willow around the heel, so they could jump.
But before jumping, when the ski was used purely for transport, only the toe had to be attached. As competitions began, a higher degree of control was required, so the foot had to be fastened to the ski by increasingly rigid means.
Then we have to look upon the ski history as a toe, a total. In the last century, we had ski fun.
Skis reached the Alps in the mid-19th century, and the techniques that the Norwegians were beginning to develop were adapted and improved upon to cope with the steeper slopes. Styles, fashions, and technology have evolved. But there has been little change to après-ski. Today, skiing has become a multi-billion dollar leisure industry with over 2,000 resorts worldwide. Japan, the fastest growing ski nation, has 700 resorts alone. 30 million people ski, and technology constantly updates the equipment to make skiing both easier and more comfortable. Styles have changed, but the basic mechanics of how a ski works must have remained the same. How, therefore, does a ski work?
When the ski goes over the snow, the surface of the snow is compressed by the ski and actually melts ever so slightly, and you then run on a cushion of water. If you pick up a handful of snow, squeeze it very hard, water will run out from the snowball. Every child knows this. When he makes snowballs, he gets a handful of water if he presses too hard.
As a basic explanation of how skis work, this description is adequate. But in high-performance racing, it is necessary to examine the mechanism much more closely. Those scientists who study friction, lubrication, and wear of sliding surfaces are called tribologists.
When a ski is moving on the snow, first of all, you have compaction, deformation of snow, temperature has been increased, pressure is increasing too, a little bit. Then melted snow gives a little bit of water, and you are sliding on this water, continuous or discontinuous. So in these cases, you have to be interesting in rheology of snow. Rheology means science of flow and deformation.
A scanning electron microscope is used for detailed examination of surfaces. This attention to detail has paid off, as Dr. Mattia's team have helped French canoeists and sailors to win Olympic medals. This technique is only a visual check in surface preparation, but for more precise research purposes, a quantitative approach is needed. Now, Dr. Mattia has turned his attention to skiing and is employing precision measurement techniques to the ski surface. This apparatus works in a similar way to a record player stylus by amplifying tiny surface details.
We are working with a three-dimensional topographic analyzer, which has been specially built for ski, giving isometric images in 3D.
From these results, computer models of ski bases allow mathematical analysis and prediction of performance.
If you are able to be between very rough ski surfaces and compressed snow surfaces, you will very easily identify the summits of asperities scratching on snow crystals.
This model shows, in an exaggerated way, just how rough the ski-snow interface is. To improve the surface of the ski base, it must be polished, although not to a totally smooth finish, as that would not hold ski waxes, and curiously, a degree of roughness appears to be beneficial. Polishing is done by grinding wheels. These can damage the polyethylene base if grinding is too harsh. Here, scratch tests are used to determine the precise parameters for optimum grinding.
Let me show what goes on between each grain of grinding wheel and surface. Of course, it's analogical modeling. If sliding is slow enough, the roughness is very smooth. If grinding wheel is moving rapidly, you can very easily simulate fractures, and ski surfaces become brittle. In some cases, it can be very useful in order to absorb some molecule of waxes. So optimum is in between.
Using these techniques, Dr. Mathieu and his colleagues have taken one of the French speed ski team from 35th place in the world ranking to second place in one season. Without the huge leisure-based industry, research into speed skiing would not happen. However, the lessons learned by pushing technology to the limit in extreme competition filter back for the benefit of all skiers. Speed skiing research, like motor racing, is funded by manufacturers who use high-level competitions as a testing ground for new products, designs, and experimentation in their continuing quest for the ideal ski.
The idea would be to catch, to maintain the maximum of air to build the air layer under the ski. And for that, the idea is to make the ski very long and very wide. And as regards the water, on very dry snow, the gliding is not good. So to be fast, the ski must be able to create a certain amount of water, but in the shape of very small pieces of water. But even if we have air and water, we have also a dry friction. And for this component of the friction, we have to act to adjust the viscoelastic qualities, characteristic of the material of the bottom, of the polyethylene. These are the main parameters.
We don't want too much water. We need some water to actually lubricate the ski, but too much, the surface tension builds up and the ski will go slower. So what we are trying to achieve is a similar effect to a car tire. The structure and the wax help to disperse the water underneath the ski, leaving enough for the ski to run, but not so much that it actually slows down the ski.
Even the earlier skiers realized that bare wood was not the best surface for the base of their skis. Every family had its secret recipe.
How to make old wax, that was a magic. That was a secret. And we know from the Vikings that they used tar, and it smells so lovely, and we still use tar.
Among other ingredients in ski-improving potions were cheese, herring, salt, and beeswax. From dark beginnings verging on alchemy, waxing has developed into a precise science. No ski base has been designed that can cope with a vast range of snow types. Waxes allow ski bases to be adjusted to suit the conditions. In that way, the skier is always getting the best performance.
It's partly a dry friction, and it's partly a wet friction. We can say it's a mixed friction. And because of this, it's a fairly complicated frictional phenomena. If we take ordinary friction, let's say this kind of friction we have here, it's a porcelain against wood. It is a simple frictional phenomena because here it's possible to analyze this material and give fairly good explanations of both. But when one of the frictional partners is snow, then the difficulty starts because snow is a material very close to its melting point. Well, speed skiers are no exception among the skiers. They are helped by waxes just the same way as alpine skiers, ski jumpers, downhillers. It means that this wax layer has chemical qualities better than the pure base itself. If you had run this speed skis without wax, the contact had been between polyethylene and snow, and this contact create more friction than this very thin layer of wax just at the surface of the polyethylene. Ceraif is a fluorocarbon. In fact, it's a fairly simple chemical compound made up by carbon and fluorine, very similar to hydrocarbons, except for the fact that in this substance you have fluorine substituted for hydrogen. So this is a material which has been known for a long time, but the product itself has been very difficult to produce. But for some years it was available in small amounts, and since then it has been more and more popular among skiers. The price is very high. This little box here, about 30 grams, cost $100. It's something in between the price of gold and silver.
Oil is used to lubricate sliding surfaces. Chemically, oils and waxes are very similar. They are both hydrocarbon chains, and all that differs is their melting points. Different oils are used for different jobs. Ski waxes have even finer specifications. And of course, solid lubricants such as graphite are not unusual. Cera F is a solid. It's also hydrophobic, that is, water-repelling, which is why the water droplets are raised off the surface and glide with very little resistance. It has precise parameters. Without high humidity and a temperature range of -4 to +4 centigrade, this wax won't work. Polymer scientists use scanning electron microscope techniques to observe the chemical adhesion of wax coatings on the ski surfaces.
Waxing and structuring together could make a difference of about 5 kilometers per hour if somebody got it totally wrong from the person who got it absolutely spot on. The difference between first place and 50th place.
Get the waxing right in any form of competition skiing, and you've just fitted the equivalent of a turbocharger. Get the waxing wrong, and you'd still be coming down this slope halfway through the adverts. Speed skis are not ordinary skis. They are designed specially for KL, Le Kilomètre Lancé.
We cannot design the ski as long as we want, because when running the KL, the ski receives big shocks and is going like that, links on the right. And if the ski is very heavy, it has a very high inertia, and it will bring the skier with itself. The skier must have enough weight to be able to balance the proper inertia of the ski. So there is a real limit in length, and you can see that all the KL skis are about 2 meters and 40 centimeters. As regards the width, to catch more air, there is a disadvantage is that increasing the width, you increase the wet drag. The width of the water film you have to shear works against the performance.
One of the side effects of traveling over a not entirely perfect slope at high speed is vibration. The problem is further compounded in speed skiing. As the skis go airborne at speeds above 85 miles per hour and are continually touching down before flying again. Ski manufacturers must test for basic properties in the laboratory. Speed skis are tested through a wide range of wavelengths, researchers watching for any sudden uncontrollable responses. Any problem wavelengths can be controlled by adjusting the damping during manufacture. Part of a downhill ski's ability to turn comes from its design, which allows it to bend into a negative camber, keeping its edge in contact with the snow surface during a high-speed turn. Under the same applied pressure, the KL ski will only bend half as much as the ordinary downhill ski. Sensors positioned along the length of this test rig show the weight distribution when the ski is under a normal working load. And, of course, fine-tuning the performance of a ski must not leave it in a fragile state. This cross-country ski broke at the point it was designed to, safely beyond the level of force it is expected to encounter in normal use.
We can measure and make a mathematical treatment on the profile, fine profile of the surface, but we measure, quantify nothing really involved, directly involved in the gliding. So we have to go on snow.
Attempting to solve practical problems in the laboratory can give useful clues, but rarely can the complete picture be seen without a more applied test. The research technicians must take their experiments into the ski's environment. Several test skiers are used, each tester using several pairs of skis at high and low speed. This allows for a range of vibrations to be checked. The ski bases are waxed identically, and the differing vibration treatments are timed to show whether these affect the overall performance of the ski. Vibration control is a difficult area, particularly at high speeds, as the desired result is not the total removal of vibration. Several aspects of vibration have positive effects on skiing. It is much easier to turn a ski that is vibrating in a controlled manner than one that feels dead. Vibration also affects waxes and the ability of the speed ski to fly. The pilots of flying boats attempting to take off in flat, calm conditions find that the aircraft is reluctant to unstick, and sometimes the pilot has to cross the takeoff area simply in order to create waves. These allow air to get between the hull and the water, allowing the aircraft to take off. In speed skiing, vibration performs the same function, shearing the interface between the skis and the slope. The motto of the Royal Air Force is Per Ardua ad Astra, onward with difficulty to the stars.
Well, in my left hand I have a feather, in my right hand a hammer. And I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago who made a rather significant discovery about falling objects in gravity fields. And we thought that where would be a better place to confirm his findings than on the moon? And so we thought we'd try it here for you. The feather happens to be appropriately a falcon feather for our falcon. And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that? Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Coming back down to Earth, it's a little different. We have an atmosphere which is sufficiently dense to allow flight to occur. The similarity between a ski jumper and a speed skier is not immediately obvious, but in fact, they are both flying. Here at Trondheim University, Professor Helga Norstrud has taken his student interest in ski jumping and integrated it into his professional research, the study of aerodynamics. Using Barbie's boyfriend Ken in a smoke tunnel, he has shown ski jumpers exactly what is going on. It is now possible for them to understand the dynamics of their sport, where lift occurs and where problem vortices are forming. He has now been persuaded to turn his expertise to the assistance of speed skiers. Robbie Brown is the youngest member of the British Olympic speed ski squad. He has traveled to Norway to meet Professor Nørstrud so that he can check the effectiveness of his racing position, his tuck in the wind tunnel. Without the pressure of the race or the danger of the slope, he can experiment with that position and feel the effect of subtle changes.
Put it on first, and before you take the helmet on. And make these arms in the same line as with the legs. Maybe you can take the poles.
Yeah.
Put the poles on. Now we are going 200 kilometers. Do you feel it? When we put the helmet on, we go 220. Yeah?
At the remarkable speeds that these competitors are regularly achieving, even the tiniest aerodynamic advantage must be taken. Fairings are fitted behind the calves to ensure a smooth flow of air around the legs, preventing inefficient turbulence from being created. Helmets are designed for each individual speed skier, and even the clips on their ski boots are smoothed out with adhesive tape to stop them presenting rough surfaces to the 200 kilometer per hour airflow.
Helmets, there's various designs of helmets. The peak at the back's essentially is to fill the nape of your neck so that there's no drag behind your head. You can also steer with your helmet. You can get shoulder fairings fitted to your helmet, which put the air over your shoulders and your back a little more smoothly if you're suited to that.
As well as the helmet being of the optimum aerodynamic design, attention has to be paid to all aspects of speed skiers' clothing. The suit is skin-tight neoprene rubber, which is not entirely smooth. This traps a microscopic layer of air on the surface, reducing the skin drag.
And then 10 kilometers per hour.
Nice cool breeze.
Did you could feel the change of your legs and arms?
Yeah.
Was it a natural position for you, or did you feel it was sort of a normal thing?
It was, my actual tuck felt very natural. When I stuck my elbows out deliberately, the increased drag was noticeable.
Oh, yeah. That's why it's important to have this one aligned with this one, with your legs. There's one positive force, and that's the gravity, or the component of the gravity along the slope. And then you have two negative forces, the aerodynamic drag and the friction between the skis and the slope. Those three forces are not always in balance, drag and friction and gravity. So there's a fourth force pulling the skiers down. And when that force goes to zero, then you have reached terminal velocity. And those pictures up here can explain why and how. You have the drag, the friction, those are negative. And you have the gravity components along the slope and one normal. And to keep this in balance, there is an acceleration force pulling you down the hill. When this reaches zero, then there's a balance between those three forces, and you have approached or reached terminal velocity, which all depends on the mass of the body the drag of the body and the slope, so it's not one single number. For a parachutist, it also depends on the drag and on gravity, and that's a different number.
To what we might expect, speed skiers travel faster than free-fall parachutists. This is true because their aims are completely different. The skydiver tries to stay in free-fall as long as possible by lowering his terminal velocity and presenting the largest surface area to the air. Speed skiers reduce their frontal area to go faster. When a skydiver does this, his acceleration is very rapid indeed. The world speed record for free-fall is 625.2 miles per hour, Mach 1. It's baking bread. Baking man. Some shapes are more naturally aerodynamic than others. Abrupt changes in an object's profile can be inefficient and costly. For this reason, an object which is designed to go quickly, like a racing car, employs many of the same aerodynamic features as a competition speed skier. Efficient shaping, surface preparations, and fairings. This caravan model illustrates a theory of aerodynamic control in speed skiing. Improve the aerodynamic situation, and the system becomes more efficient. It's been calculated that after only 500 miles of motoring, this spoiler will have paid for itself, a lesson in economy for speed skiers. For speed skiers who don't have access to a wind tunnel, they have to find other aerodynamic simulators.
Tony, it was a very nice ride. It was quite a nice ride. I have been in a higher speed, but in this kind of roads you cannot drive too fast.
1971, when I was doing speed skiing, I didn't have too much possibility to train at home in Finland, so we get up to the top of the car. It was in Italy, and we start developing the sport. It was very, very nice to train with it. You have to be first sure that you stay on the top of the car, you don't fall down.
Okay.
This method of training has now been banned internationally. The original flying kilometer at St. Moritz. This is where it all began in 1930. The first record was 65 miles per hour and remained unbroken for 2 years. 70 miles per hour was the next goal. In 1933, Austrian Leo Gasperl shattered the record and raised it to a staggering 84 miles per hour. Various experiments included the use of these aerodynamic rucksacks. 20 years ago, the record was just over 100 miles per hour. Nowadays, that is the qualifying speeds for skiers to take part in a race.
I settled into my tuck. I felt tight and felt good. I was telling myself to attack it all the way. And suddenly I felt my two skis clatter together. And the next thing, I was just bouncing around. I could feel a tremendous amount of heat on my elbow, the friction of the snow burning, sort of rolling around, trying to get off that pressure point before it burnt too badly. As it is, it's just the skin's just grazed off, and I'm sort of stiff and tender, very tender. Very fortunate, a guy fell early before me and broke both legs. So, really, very lucky.
Speed skiing is a hazardous activity. There have been numerous breaks and burns, and two people have already lost their lives. In both cases, they had tightened their tuck to a point where they were skiing blind and hit the timing apparatus. Anyone judged to be skiing without vision is now disqualified. However, the element of danger is unlikely to be a limiting factor in speed skiing progress.
I think speed skiing has a good future. We have now got speed skiing as an Olympic sport, albeit a demonstration sport in 92, hopefully a full sport in 94. In the Olympics, I feel that we have a very good chance of perhaps getting one, maybe two medals, all things being equal, cash being provided, and the necessary technical backup.
150 miles per hour, over twice the speed limit in a motorway. Can they do it?
I think it's possible. It seems to be possible. Because one part of the loss of control comes from vibration. And if we are able to increase the stability of the ski, the speed limit is higher. So this speed, I should say it's possible.
It's going to take a very strong person, both physically and psychologically, to be able to do it. Physically, because of the turbulence that's created at that speed, and the wind pressure against you are phenomenal. And psychologically, simply because to keep your head down at, you know, a foot off the snow at that sort of speed is does take a very strong heart and mind.
It depends on the man, but he can't do it alone. So he needs a sportman, industrialist, and scientist, and of course, the media.
I think it's possible at a high altitude. It's hard to say. The fastest I've been is 124 miles per hour, and I know I can go faster than that.
It seems that this record has been improved all the time. So by finding some excellent conditions, first of all, I think it's important to be at very high altitudes, because at those velocities, the resistance, the air resistance, is a big part of the total friction. So that means going high up into the, let's say, the Himalayas, have an excellent trail, very, very steep, find very hard snow, crusty, with very little contact area between snow and ski. That means you are literally flying.
Sometimes they say in Italy that we never reach 180, and I was the first one over 180. And then they say you cannot go 190, and then Steve McKinney, USA, broke the 190, and then they say not possible 200, and he broke that one too. So I think there is no line.
150 miles an hour. Let me check my friend.
I'm ready to do it, and I don't know if anybody else can do it, but I can do it, and I hope I'll be the first one.
Yes, I think so.
It wouldn't surprise me to see it in the Olympics in 92. Probably by Mr. Prufer.
Alors 240, c'est une très très haute vitesse. La piste, actuellement, le record du monde, c'est 223. Je crois qu'en 91, on peut espérer faire autour de 230 à l'heure. Et pour 92 et pour la démonstration olympique ici, je pense que 240, ça sera possible.
150 miles per hour. Well, they think so. It's only a question of time.